Hi everyone, in this lecture I am going to deal about the scrotum and the testes, which are the part of male reproductive system. First I talk about the scrotum, as it is supportive structure which support the testes, and it is formed by a skin as well as subcutaneous layer. So here you can see it is a pouch like structure, and it is attaches with the root of penis. Internally, this sac-like structure is divided into two parts by a scrotal septum, and this septum is formed by subcutaneous layer as well as the dartus muscle, thus it forming two parts internally, and each part consisting of a testes, which is the male gonad. Within these compartments, the testes are covered by a muscle, here you can see bilaterally, and these are termed as cremaster muscles. The cremaster muscle is the extension of internal oblique muscle. So these muscle fibers regulate the temperature of the testes within the scrotum, as the testes produces sperm, and for the constant production they require 2 to 3 degrees Celsius below the core body temperature. But at the time of cold weather, these muscles become contract and causes the testes closure to the body wall, so that they can easily absorb the heat and maintain the temperature which requires for the normal sperm production. The next we talk about is the testes, and these are the paired male gonads which lies within the scrotum outside the pelvic cavity, and it measures about 5 cm in length and 2.5 cm wide, and weight is about 10 to 15 gram each. Let's have interior view of the testes, and here in this you can see the outermost lining of the testes is termed as tunica vaginalis, and it is a serous membrane which is derived from the peritoneum. When the testes become descent into the scrotum outside the pelvic cavity, it forms a sac-like structure which covers the testes externally, and it enters through the inguinal ring. At the upper end where it enters, it becomes obliterated, but at the lower end it forms a sac-like structure which covers the testes, and internal to this is the lining which is termed as tunica albuginea, and it is white capsule-like structure which forms a septa or the division internally, here you can see. And these septas form many compartments within the testes, and these are termed as lobules. And within each testes there are 200 to 300 lobules, and each lobules consisting of 1 to 3 coiled seminiferous tubules, here it is. And these seminiferous tubules produce sperm, and this process is termed as spermatogenesis. So here in this figure we can see the interior of seminiferous tubule, and this is the wall of seminiferous tubule in which you can see the process of spermatogenesis. And there are two type of cells within that, and these are the spermatogenic cells and the Sertoli cells. The spermatogenic cells forms the sperm, and the Sertoli cells support these sperm cells. These spermatogenic cells develops from the stem cell, that is spermatogonia, and these are attaches with the basement membrane, and they give rise to the primary spermatocytes, secondary spermatocytes, spermatids, and then to the sperms. And Sertoli cell nourishes them and remove the excess cytoplasm within them and control their release into the lumen of seminiferous tubule. There are the spaces within the seminiferous tubules, and within that there are the cells. These are termed as interstitial cells or the Leydig cells, which releases one androgen hormone, that is testosterone, and which promote the development of masculine characteristics. At puberty it bring about the changes in male, such as the enlargement of male sex organs, the secondary sexual characteristics development, that is the muscular as well as skeletal growth, the thickening of the skin, the enlargement of the larynx. So the male voice is more deepened as compared to female. The Sertoli cells also forms A blood testis barrier, that is a physical barrier between the Sertoli cells as well as the blood vessels, and these Sertoli cells join together by the tight junction. Here it is. So the Sertoli cells help to prevent the toxic substances to enter into the seminiferous tubule, and that can be damaged to the sperm cell. So as the mature sperm is released into the seminiferous tubule, it is more adaptable for reaching and penetrating a secondary oocyte. Now we have a figure of sperm. It has two parts. One is head and the another is tail. The head part is 4 to 5 micrometer long, and it consisting of the nucleus. At the tip of the nucleus, there is a cap-like vesicle which is termed as acrosome, and it is filled with the enzymes that help in penetrating the secondary oocyte, and the enzymes are hyaluronidase and the proteases. The tail of the sperm is divided into the neck region, the middle piece, the principal piece, and the tapering ending portion is the end piece. The narrow constructed neck region is just behind the head, and it consists of centriole, and behind that is the middle piece, which consists of mitochondria, and it provides the energy, that is ATP, for the locomotion of sperm so that it can easily fertilize the secondary oocyte. Then comes the principal piece. It is the longest portion, and the at the end is the end piece. So once it is ejaculated, these do not survive more than 48 hours within the female reproductive tract, and there are around 300 million sperms which completed the process of spermatogenesis every day. So here in this animation, you can see the blood supply to the testes, and there is right as well as left testicular artery, which is the branch of abdominal aorta, and it descends through the inguinal canal. And the venous drainage of this is by the right testicular vein, and this drain into the inferior vena cava, whereas the left testicular vein drains into the left renal vein, instead it drains into the inferior vena cava. So here we have seen the scrotum and the testes. Thank you for watching this video. Please subscribe our channel, and for more lectures you can visit our site.